This is Channel 7 Eyewitness News with Tim Fleischer and Rolando Watts, Scott Clark with sports, Sam Champion with the weather, and the Eyewitness News team. Now, Eyewitness News.
Good evening, I'm Tim Fleischer, and here's what's happening. Tonight, the world is waiting to see who will blink first in China. There's an uneasy standoff in Beijing, with many wondering, will there be a confrontation between students and soldiers? There was talk of a deadline by which the students had to leave their stronghold in Tiananmen Square. That deadline passed, and now the tension grows each hour. Tonight, we spoke to ABC correspondent Nathan Thomas in Beijing.
5 o'clock came and went, and nothing happened. The government is telling us that that they never really had set a deadline. And I think what's happened is there is division among the government as to exactly what they're doing.
The students, meanwhile, continue their stronghold on Beijing, tens of thousands occupying Tiananmen Square and marching through the streets in their standoff for freedom. Soldiers, thousands of them, are also in the midst of this standoff, ordered in by the government.
The military people are showing no sign that they have really any interest in going anywhere. They certainly, with a tank, could force their way through some people if that's what they were ordered to do.
But so far, there are no orders. Many soldiers like these here at this train station listen to the students who advocate passive resistance.
If they beat us, we'll not fight back. We'll simply stand there and let them be.
The potential for violence is certainly there, but both sides are being very, very restrained.
That standoff is now entering its 10th day.
Well, large-scale demonstrations in support of the students in Beijing have now spread to other cities. Hundreds of thousands of people marched through the streets of Shanghai. The city's famed waterfront was mobbed with demonstrators, and the government pulled its police force off the streets, leaving whatever traffic was moving in complete chaos. In Hong Kong, an estimated 400,000 people took to the streets, marching through the city for 3 hours. Staff members of China's news agency joined the rally with a banner. It was in support of the Beijing students. Hong Kong is a British colony that returns to Chinese rule in 1997. And then, of course, back on our shores, President Bush is speaking out. He has called on the Beijing students to be peaceful, but to still stand up for what they believe in. The president said he would not dictate, nor would he try to say how this matter should be resolved, but he said he just doesn't want to see any bloodshed.
Rolanda, Irish protesters took their cause to Midtown Manhattan tonight, where Britain's Prince Charles, or Prince Philip, rather, made an appearance for charity. A small group stood behind barricades across from the Plaza Hotel, shouting slogans against the presence of British troops in Northern Ireland. The protest was peaceful inside Prince Philip, with Donald Trump at his side, appealed for help to rebuild Shakespeare's theater on its original site in London.
And on Long Island, we have the death of a skydiver to report. A plunge of 3,000 feet took the life of a 28-year-old man. It was his first attempt following a parachuting class. And David Navarro explains what went so terribly wrong.
Skydiving enthusiasts call it the thrill of a lifetime. But yesterday evening, as friends watched in horror, that thrill turned to tragedy as a skydiving student making his first jump fell to his death. FAA and Suffolk County investigators examined 28-year-old Jack Riley's equipment after the Belmore Long Island skydiver was killed when his emergency chute did not open. The owner of the jump school believes Riley could have survived his first mistake if he hadn't panicked at about 300 feet above the ground. The thrill seeker's trouble began when he failed to exit the plane in the proper body position.
The parachute did deploy. It was opened up partially. He should have, after 5 seconds, recognized that he did have a problem. He should have just come in and pulled the emergency handle, and he would have been fine.
And then his instructors say panic set in. As Riley lost track of time, he pulled the emergency cord too close to the ground, which disengaged the main chute, slowing his descent.
When he released the handle, that released that main parachute that was partially open, and if he had stayed with that, he might have just broken his leg. But he was so close to the ground that the reserve did not have enough time to come out.
Two of Riley's friends who had landed moments earlier watched helplessly from the ground as the 28-year-old fell to the earth. Despite the tragedy, the skydiving school was back in the air this afternoon. The owner of the school says he's been in operation for 7 years without incident. So far, no charges against the school have been filed as the investigation into the death continues. Reporting from East Mauritius, Long Island, David Navarro, Channel 7 Eyewitness News.
And those two friends that David pointed out there who had taken the class with Riley were aboard that plane when he jumped.
There was an outpouring of goodwill in Manhattan today. It was the fourth annual AIDS Walk, and at least 15,000 people took part. The walk covered 6.2 miles of the Upper West Side, and every step was taken to focus attention on the AIDS crisis here in our city. And because of today's AIDS Walk, an estimated $2.5 million was raised to help the work of the Gay Men's Health Crisis, one of the leading support groups here in the city. A different kind of walk, more a trek across the frozen Arctic to the North Pole, certainly one of the most, or one that we can only imagine. Braving the dangers, though, one Harlem-born explorer now living in Brooklyn has now accomplished that feat and left his mark. Tonight he is home, and Tappy Phillips has his story.
Daryl Roberts' cheeks still show the signs of frostbite he encountered on his 56-day, 600-mile trek to the North Pole. At 23, Daryl is the youngest person ever to visit the pole, marching often 16 hours a day in the bitter cold, blazing sun and wind.
The sun was very intense, so you're exposed to the sun and you're exposed to the cold at the same time, extremes of both at the same time. And the wind, you get windburned too.
One of Daryl's purposes in making a 56-day trip in the bitter cold was to show kids that they can set ambitious goals and then achieve them. Daryl grew up in Harlem in a single-parent home, but he studied hard and went to college.
If I could do almost anything, or at least give it a go, then so can so can the kids who are selling crack and who might want more but don't know how to get it.
The trip was sponsored by the Amway Corporation at a cost of about $3 million. Their purpose was to gather air and snow samples for environmental studies and to promote cooperation between countries. There were explorers from 7 countries, including Russia and Japan, on this trip.
We worked together through all the language barriers, overcoming all these ice obstacles, the cold, the tension, living so close, hunched together in a tent, and we all made it.
Daryl says once to the North Pole was enough, but he plans other adventures, and his most rewarding trip may be to schools around the country, inspiring other youngsters to dream. In Brooklyn, Tappy Phillips, Channel 7 Eyewitness News.
And for the record, Daryl Roberts is the youngest man ever to make that journey to the North Pole.
I bet he welcomed those 80-degree temperatures. Welcome home, Daryl. When Eyewitness News continues, there is a new clue in the search for a missing 2-year-old child from Harlem. Police have someone they say they want to talk to.
And 2 teenage suspects arrested in a brutal murder on Long Island. Stay with us.
Police tonight are saying that they have a possible lead into the disappearance of a 2-year-old, Christopher Danby. The little boy was last seen on a playground Thursday. The police say they have a sketch of a man who was seen in the vicinity of the playground at 114th Street and Lenox Avenue. That was late Thursday afternoon. That's about the same time that little Christopher vanished. Police say they do not consider the man in the sketch to be a suspect and that they just want to question him.
And tonight, police are still looking for a group of teenagers who they say robbed and fought with passengers waiting for a subway in Brooklyn early this morning. Between 15 and 20 teenagers were reportedly drinking when investigators say they stole jewelry, sunglasses, and other items from 6 people. They did not take any money. No one was seriously injured in the fighting. 2 teenagers from Long Island are under arrest tonight for a brutal beating of a 26-year-old man. The lifeless body of Sean Ferguson was discovered last Wednesday in a vacant lot in Bellport. Police suspect 16-year-old Leonard Holland and 17-year-old Charlie Swan of killing the man in a drug-related robbery. Neither suspect pleaded to the charges. The judge ordered they be held without bail. A hearing has been set for next Friday.
And in Atlantic City, the Atlantis Casino Hotel is going to close down, well, in just a few hours. It will be the first state-ordered shutdown of a gaming hall in Atlantic City since the casino gambling began there in 1978. The New Jersey Casino Control Commission last week voted unanimously to close the casino, ending the Atlantis's long history of financial troubles. The commission says that the casino's $144 million debt presents too big a risk to the industry's integrity to allow continued wagering.
When we continue with Eyewitness News, lots of runs as the Mets take on the Giants. But who scored all those runs? Scott Clark's got all the sports for us.
And a big blow from Steve Balboni. The Yankees battle the Mariners.
He rips one to deep center field.